Good morning and welcome to All Faith Sunday Service. It is Sunday, June 21st, and a happy Father's Day to all fathers and those who father. I'm the Reverend CJ McGregor, and I serve this congregation as its minister, and I'll be leading our service this morning. I have a few announcements. There will be an adult program. Angel Wings will be making a presentation at 11:30 this morning. Please check your email for the Zoom instructions. There will be no Zoom coffee hour after the service today. So please join the Hearts for the Homeless team and join in the Angel Wings program. Next Sunday, we will be live streaming the service at 10 a.m. from the UUA's General Assembly. This is the largest gathering of Unitarian Universalists, so we will be sending you details to follow to join in that service. Again, it's next Sunday at 10 a.m., and watch your emails from the office so you will know how to join in. That will be our service next Sunday. On July 5th, our Summer of Music series begins. We will be adding more music to the service so from July 5th through August, so please join us for those services. At All Faith, we want you to know that no matter who you are, wherever you are on your spiritual journey, or whomever you love, you are always welcome here. So please join in our opening hymn number 361, Enter, Rejoice, and Come In. Printed in your order of service as I light the chalice. Let this flame remind us that a world of beauty and love is coming and that we must shape it together. When we are together, we share our joys and sorrows. And though we're apart and our sanctuary is as empty as a Trump rally, I offer that you send your joys and sorrows to me, and I will be glad to share them with the congregation. We have a couple joys and sorrows this morning. Please keep Kendra Maroon and Donna Lieber in your thoughts. Kendra was hospitalized, but is now home, but has some recovery to do. Ariel Hoover and Bob Moore will celebrate 34 years of marriage tomorrow, so reach out and congratulate them. Again, if you have joys or sorrows and would like to share them with the congregation, please send them to me. Let us share a few moments of silence. Our opening words this morning are from Sophia Lyon Falls, one of our greatest religious educators. She writes, "We gather in reverence before the wonder of life, the wonder of this moment, the wonder of being together, so close, yet so apart. Each hidden in our own secret chamber, each listening, each trying to speak, yet none fully understanding, none fully understood. We gather in reverence before all intangible things that eyes see not, nor ears can detect, that hands can never touch, that space can never hold, and time cannot measure. It is good to be together."
Fractured moonlight on the sea, reflections still look the same to me as before I went under. And it's peaceful in the deep cathedral where you cannot breathe. No need to pray, no need to speak. And now I am under, and it's breaking over me, a thousand miles down to the sea. Found a place to rest my head. Never let me go, never let me go, never let me go, never let me go. And the arms of the ocean are carrying me, and all this devotion was rushing out of me. And the crashes are heaven for a sinner like me. But the arms of the ocean delivered me. Though the pressure's hard to take, it's the only way I can escape. It seems a heavy choice to make. For now I'm under, and it's breaking. Thank you.
Our reading this morning is titled, People Are Good at Heart, and it's written by a youth leader, Dina Madison, and Dina is in the seventh grade. There is goodness inside of everyone, though you have to look deep to find it. Even though people can be deceiving at first, they have goodness inside of them. For example, my parents tell my brothers and I to help and pray for people in need. Or another example would be doing something so kind that the person was deeply touched and was willing to give back. Sometimes people need a second chance to correct their mistakes and restart. People who are judged too many times start losing their confidence in themselves and others too. Being open to those in need helps repair the damage done by those who have judged. Some examples are cheering someone up when they were down because someone was or maybe still being mean to them. And I had a personal experience like that happen to me. I was at my brother's baseball game and a couple of older guys came over by the bleachers where I was. And while I didn't do anything, and they just beat me up with their nasty and unkind words. And after the game was over, I tried to forget about it. Forget about that whole bogus scene, but it made me feel pretty cruddy. And I never really went to any of my brother's games again. I had several experiences that hurt me in my heart, and in a way, it sort of scared me. I never knew that I had the potential to win a national essay contest or the DAR essay contest in last year in sixth grade. If I listened to what other people had said about me and became negative, I would have never done so well. Having a positive attitude, not paying attention to people's rude and unnecessary comments about me, helped me overcome the tough obstacle of life so far. I had so many friends who told me, don't listen to other people's opinions about you. Everywhere you go, there will be people we won't like. There are also those who try to help improve the world and people in it, step by step. Even though I've already met unkind people, and I'm only in the seventh grade, I have noticed that they are trying to improve and not judge. I am proud of the people who want to change. I am still learning to stop judging others. You can find goodness in other people if you just look deep down. And all of those people trying to improve are changing the world step by step. And so ends the reading. Please join in hymn number 95, There Is More Love Somewhere. The lyrics are printed on the bottom of your order of service. Thank you. messages this month are exploring good and evil. And I think you know where I'm going with the theme Banished from the Garden, which, of course, the story of Adam and Eve as told in the book of Genesis in the Old Testament. Many believe that Adam and Eve were banished from the garden because they ate the fruit from the tree of knowledge against God's will. And as the story goes, that did happen. They did eat from the tree of knowledge. But it's not the reason Adam and Eve were sent out of the garden. You see, there were two special trees in the garden, the tree of knowledge and the tree of life. God didn't want Adam and Eve to eat from the tree of life like they had of the tree of knowledge. So he guarded the tree of life with a golden sword and some cherubs. And he then banished the couple from the garden. To eat from the tree of life, you need to be innocent. And Adam and Eve had already screwed up. They were no longer innocent, knowing shame and envy, extortion and war. These are all known to them because of their stolen knowledge. And so basically God said, you're both losers and I'm getting you out of here before you do any more damage. And so we have a context for sin and a context for evil. We Unitarian Universalists seem not to have much use for sin or the concept or even the word. And why is that? We most often refer to the theological doctrine of original sin as being completely useless and probably damaging to the human spirit, our own for sure and probably for everyone. A. Powell Davies, who was the minister of All Souls Church in Washington, D.C., from the 40s and the 50s, sums up this dilemma nicely. He wrote, in times of stress, people do strange things. People do strange things, useless things, futile and unavailing. A drowning man, we are told, will grasp at a straw. He is unable to help it. He knows perfectly well that the straw will not keep him afloat. But his hand goes out compulsively to grab the straw, and he cannot keep it back. And people have been willing to go to almost any length to avoid looking at realities. I have never agreed with those who tried to tell us that the whole idea of sin is out of date. To the best of my observation and belief, sin is highly trendy, and we are all up to our necks in it presently. But this doesn't mean that to avoid drowning in sin, we must clutch to theological straws. It doesn't mean that we must surrender all attempts at swimming our way to the shore. Nor does it mean that there is nothing left to do but call for a miracle. Sin is useless for two reasons. First, to suggest that each and every human being is conceived and born in sin and then carries that sin until a designated holy person washes that sin away is irrational at best. Second, and perhaps more important for Unitarian Universalists, the notion that a loving God would place the first human beings in a beautiful garden and then set them up for almost certain failure by highlighting the marvelous nature of the trees of knowledge and life and then forbidding them to touch them. That sort of manipulation by a God insults us. If God is this mean and terrible, then we have no use for that God. We reject this mean and terrible God and throw out the concept of original sin as being completely inconsistent with a loving and merciful God. What happens when we as Unitarian Universalists do away with sin altogether? We end up having not a useful religious understanding of sin within our Unitarian Universalist worldview. My colleague, the Reverend Barbara Beckman, tells a story where she was chatting up some of her minister colleagues at a minister's retreat. And a couple of them asked what she would be preaching about that day, and she said, sin. And the common response from her, from the other ministers was, "Whoa, really? You're going to talk about sin? Good luck with that." And even her nearby colleague and friend looked at her curiously and said, "Really? You're going to talk about sin? That's so brave. What will you say?" And they chatted for 40 minutes, apparently. And finally, she said, the friend said, "Okay, I think that would be worth listening to." "When we ministers are stumped," she says, "it's no wonder we don't talk about sin in Unitarian Universalist company. Yet I think we must. In times of social and moral trouble, like the times we are living in right now, it's time to talk about sin. It's time to re-envision our notions about sin and create a useful process for responding to evil in our world. What happened to bring us to this place of evil? We tossed out the whole notion of sin because we have such a deep aversion to the concept of original sin. We tossed out the useful along with the useless, the baby with the bathwater. Liberal theologians wrestled with the reality of evil and the rejection of original sin over the decades, and we now find ourselves in a curious place where we ought not to be. In rejecting original sin, we have, for all practical purposes, rejected sin in any guise. This is a problem for contemporary people of faith, especially for people of a liberal and progressive faith. Amy Butler, minister of a Riverside church, says that because we progressives have so much difficulty with traditional conservative Christian descriptions of sin, we can't talk about it at all, not even in a progressive way. And so what is the result? Those with the very theologies we find so problematic have taken over the entire conversation about sin, and it is most often cast as the personal sin of others and them, which is not infrequently you and me. The Greek word for sin means missing the mark, as an archer shooting an arrow toward the target misses the bullseye mark in the middle. And our behavior can miss the mark of correct behavior. This happens individually and collectively. And in this understanding, a wrong has been committed and consequences will follow. Opinion columnist David Brooks once wrote a piece in the New York Times called "The Case for Reparations," in which he describes sin as anything that assaults the moral order. Sin is anything that assaults the moral order. And I can go with that understanding. It provides room for personal misdeeds and collective misdeeds by both acts of commission and acts of omission. So we can talk about personal acts of racism, for example, as sin, and we can talk about our nation's sin of historical and institutional racism as good examples. But there is another richer concept of sin. Sin is a problem because with sin comes loss. Too often in our world, rather than placing our attention on that which has been lost, when we recognize sin, we have focused on punishment and retribution, like in the Old Testament. So let us reject this way of understanding sin and therefore the consequences of sin. Let us change our viewpoint and begin to look for what is lost through sins or misdeeds. When we begin to appreciate and understand what is lost, we may find much more productive and life-affirming ways of responding to sin that brings us ever closer to restoration and to wholeness. If we begin to see sin as resulting in loss and brokenness, then we are not served by throwing out sin altogether. As Powell Davies reminds us, evil is real, very real, and evil acts have very real consequences. Have you been following our president lately? Grasping at straws or burying in our heads in the sand in these times is not helpful. So what is the helpful way of confronting evil within ourselves, others, or our collective historical, cultural, or social evil? Look for what we've lost. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve ate the fruit of the tree of knowledge, and we think that was the sin. But the sin was acting in a way that resulted in the loss of their relationship with their God, for the consequences of their actions only became real when they refused to take responsibility and work to restore what was lost or broken. And remember in the story, with their newly acquired knowledge, Adam and Eve covered their nakedness. And when God saw them in their new fig leaf finery, God knew something changed. And God asked Adam about it, and Adam denied, deflected, and redirected. And that is what angered God. Adam was not willing to engage in the process of restoring what was lost. So we can finally let Eve off the hook, maybe a little. Seeing differently, if the story paid attention to the lost, suffered relationship with the divine, and easy living in the Garden of Eden, it might have gone in a different direction. And this is a morality story, it's not history. So let's not quibble about the details and lose the point. When we fall short, we suffer loss. Usually this is a loss of relationship. And the next thing is to work for restoration, to make the relationship whole again. But if I have thrown out any meaning for sin, then there is no need for the process of restoration, and the loss remains. The brokenness becomes permanent. We have no theological or philosophical way to talk about or deal with the results in a life-affirming way. We punish and cast out the sinners, just as the story in the Old Testament. Relationships are broken forever. We suffer the consequences of a faith-crushing, life-limiting brokenness. And in another mode, we see evil, personal and collective, and we do have a way of talking about it as a loss of something we cherish and value. We strive to find ways of restoring what is lost or repairing what is damaged. And sometimes, maybe even often, we can rejoice in that renewed wholeness. May it be so. I was raised Catholic, and most Catholic families have a family Bible where they can enter significant dates and events. And so there was once a boy who was looking at his family Bible, going through it, and he found between the pages a pressed leaf that had been placed in the Bible long ago. And so he held it up and he was looking at it, and his mom came in the room and asked him, "What did you find? What is that?" And he said, "I think it's Adam's underwear." We are grateful for your offerings that help the congregation do its work. So we will now accept the offer.
Lamp oil, lovers may say, freedom.
Sorrow will one day turn to joy, and all that breaks the heart and oppresses the soul will one day give place to peace, give place to understanding, and everyone will be free. Blessed be. Before we extinguish our chalice, our Zoom coffee hour this morning is canceled, so we could all join the adult program, education program that is being presented by the Hearts from the Homeless team, Angel Wings, and check your email how to join that program. I'd like to thank Ed Elrod, who is on sound, Regina Kilmartin, who is our director and camera person, and Joseph for our music, and thank you to you for joining us this morning. Please join in the words printed in your order of service as I extinguish the chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and out into the world.